If you'll turn to John, the 12th chapter, verse 36b through 50, we're going to take a look at some who didn't believe. Follow along with me, starting at 36b. After saying these things, Jesus went away and was hidden from them. But despite all the miraculous signs Jesus had done, most of the people still did not believe in him. This is exactly what Isaiah the prophet had predicted. Lord, who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? But the people couldn't believe, for as Isaiah also said, the Lord has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, so that their eyes cannot see and their hearts cannot understand, and they cannot turn to me and have me heal them. Isaiah was referring to Jesus when he said this, but he saw the future and spoke of the Messiah's glory. Many people did believe in him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders. But they wouldn't admit it for fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue, for they loved human praise more than the praise of God. Jesus shouted to the crowds, "If you trust me, you are trusting not only me, but also God who sent me. For when you see me, you are seeing the one who sent me. I have come as a light to shine in this dark world, so that all who put their trust in me will no longer remain in the dark. I will not judge those who hear me but don't obey me, for I've come to save the world and not to judge it. But all who reject me and my message will be judged on the day of judgment by the truth I have spoken. I don't speak on my own authority. The Father who sent me has commanded me what to say and how to say it. And I know his commands lead to eternal life. So I say whatever the Father tells me to say." Now, in just a moment, we're going to be diagnosing the reality of unbelief and taking a look at the consequences of unbelief. But before we do that, there's one sore thumb that sticks out of this text that we need to take a look at on the front end. So let's do that quickly. Sore thumb number one and only this morning. I want you to please note that Jesus left the crowds and went away and hid himself from them. Verse 36b, after saying these things, Jesus went away and was hidden from them. New International says he hid himself from them. Now the question, which I want to deal with for just a couple of moments this morning, is this. Why in the world would Jesus pull out and go hide himself from the crowds? And there are a number of answers to that question. One of the reasons he withdrew and hid himself was because he, and he alone, was in charge of this whole shooting match. He was the one that was controlling time. It was his plan, not theirs. It was his decision, not theirs. Also at this time, Jesus needed to spend some crucial, deep counseling time with his disciples, telling them about what was going to take place, teaching them the things that they would need to know after he was gone. I mean, after all, his time left with the disciples was very brief, and there was so much to tell them. He needed to show them how to lead by being a servant. And so in the upper room, he takes a basin of water and a towel and he washes their feet. He needed to tell them about the Holy Spirit that would come when he left to go to heaven. He needed to tell them how the Holy Spirit was going to work in their lives. He needed to teach them the importance of prayer and all of the things that they would need to know to change the world long after the blood had dried on the cross and cobwebs had formed in an empty tomb. However, I have another reason Jesus withdrew from the crowds, and let me share it with you, because it can help us too. I believe that the pressure from all this unbelief and rejection had become so overwhelming and stressful that Jesus, being human, found it necessary to withdraw from the source of that stress. Let me tell you something. I believe that one of the causes of emotional and physical and spiritual breakdown is simply our stubborn refusal to back away from the fire when things get too hot. And our refusal to back away comes from thinking, I'm irreplaceable. This situation can't possibly come to a resolve without me in the middle of it. If I don't do it, it's simply not going to get done. I can remember back in the early years of my ministry, I had a difficult time taking time off for vacation and family time. It came from control issue and leadership fallacies that if I left, things were going to fall apart. I remember that 15 years ago when I came here, I worked 59 straight weeks without a Sunday off. I thought things would just fall apart if I wasn't here. And over the last 15 years, God has taught me a lot. He said to me not long ago, Bill, if you die, you won't even leave a hole. They'll fill that in a couple of days. And that was proven over the last couple of weeks where we took some necessary time off to relax and refresh ourselves, and you were fed greatly by Doug and by Stevie. God's going to take care of Seymour Christian. Listen, sometimes when things get really stressful, you need to back away and take care of yourself. Because if you don't take care of yourself, you're not going to be able to take care of anybody else. Some of you have a lot of people who depend on you. And if you're out of sync with the Father, it's going to have a ripple effect upon them. Jesus needed to be mentally and physically and spiritually ready to face the cross. And so he got away by himself to prepare for that. We need one-on-one time with the Father to face the crosses that we sometimes have to bear. And if you don't spend time alone with him, you're not going to be effective spending time with anybody else. There's a beautiful old legend about our author, the beloved Apostle John. He was said to have had a pet bird, a partridge, and he spent much of his time caring for and talking to that bird. And one day a Christian warrior with a bow and a quiver came along, and he said to the Apostle John, I am amazed that such a great man with awesome matters on your mind that you should spend your time caring for a simple bird. And John turned from his partridge and he said to the warrior, do you keep your bow strung tightly all the time? And the warrior said, of course not. It would be useless if I did. And the beloved apostle replied, and so would I. So would I. What was he saying? He was saying, I have to make time for myself or I won't be good for anybody else. All right, that appetizer out of the way, onto the main course for this morning, the reality of unbelief. This morning, I'm going to be talking about two kinds of people that are in this world, those who have accepted Jesus and those who haven't. I remember when I first accepted Jesus Christ and became a Christian, and then not long after that became a pastor. I remember the excitement of it all. I mean, it was like I'd found the cure for cancer. I thought if I could just tell people about it, they're going to accept him too. If I can just tell people they can be free and be forgiven and be free of the guilt in their life, live the abundant life here and live forever in heaven when they die, people are going to be lining up to accept a deal like that because that's a deal that's too good to be true. And then I found out as I told people about it, they didn't buy into it. They didn't want anything to do with it. And I couldn't understand that. I couldn't understand how people could pass up eternal life for eternal damnation. But they do every day. You see, once I had truth, it was hard for me to understand unbelief any longer. It was like standing next to a cliff and telling people, don't jump or you're going to die when you hit the rocks down below. And they say, oh, thank you, Pastor, and then they jump. It's hard for believers to understand unbelief, but it's real. And we're here for them. There are many reasons for unbelief. And so that's the subject before the house this morning, the reality of unbelief. Let's take a look at it. 5 points. We're going to move quickly. Here we go. First of all, I want you to note that unbelief is often the result of unbelief. Verses 37 through 40. But despite all the miraculous signs Jesus had done, most of the people still did not believe in him. This is exactly what Isaiah the prophet had predicted. Lord, who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? But the people couldn't believe, for as Isaiah also said, the Lord has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts so that their eyes cannot see and their hearts cannot understand, and they cannot turn to me and have me heal them. You know, when you study the passage right before this, Jesus makes it clear that there was a limit to the light. He says that he is the light. He says you will have the light just a little while longer. And unbelievers, if you keep ignoring the light, someday the light is going to be gone. I love Calvin Miller's trilogy, The Singer, The Song, and The Finale. Three wonderful books. And in The Singer, the first of those three books, The Singer is Jesus. In The Singer, there's a quote that I love that refers to Jesus when he goes to the cross. And everybody turns away from him. And Calvin Miller writes this phrase. He says, it is hard to keep on singing when the audience has turned its back. It's hard to keep on singing when the audience has turned its back. Let me tell you something. If you keep turning your back on Jesus, someday you'll look back around and he'll be gone. Let me say it again. If you keep turning your back on Jesus, someday you're going to look around and he's going to be gone. Isaiah says that unbelief breeds unbelief. And if you blatantly ignore him and think you'll never have to make a decision about him, someday you'll look back at the stage and the singer will be gone. Your heart will be hardened and you will no longer be able to say yes to Jesus. Let me tell you something I've noticed about people. The more time you think you have, the greater your tendency is to be late. Let me say it again. The more time you think you have, the greater your tendency is to be late. You know people who are late all of the time? There's a lot of arrogance and self-centeredness in being late all of the time. You ever get a coupon or gift card, gift certificate, and it has a time frame on it and you miss the time frame? On Monday when we got home, I was going through 2 weeks worth of mail that they delivered that morning. And in there was a coupon to Home Depot. It was for 10% off, and I thought, this is great, because there's some stuff that I need to get from Home Depot, and I can take this with me. And I went that day to Home Depot, and I got up to check out, and I presented that coupon, and she looked at it, and she said, this is out of date. It's expired. And I said, you got to be out of your mind. I got this while I've been gone 2 weeks ago. How can it be null and void in 2 weeks? She said it was only good for about 9 days. She said it expired yesterday on Sunday. Those extra care bucks that you get from CVS, man, I use those all the time. But I put them in my console before I've gone to get something that I need, and I look at it and it expired yesterday. So I got a roll of tape and I tape them to my dashboard now so I don't miss them. You ever get a coupon or a gift certificate that has a time limit on it? You have to use it by a certain date. You stick it away in a wallet or a purse or glove box. You keep checking the date. Finally, you go to use it. Same thing, it's expired. The more time you think you have, the greater the tendency is to be late. Thursday night is date night for Love and I. When we leave here on Thursdays, we always go someplace to eat and to talk before we go home. And one of our favorite evenings is to go to this pizza place down in Louisville called Berno's. It's a chain, and there's one that sits right at the mouth of the Second Street Bridge there in Louisville on the river. We go down from time to time, but it's the best pizza in the world. We were there back in December around Christmas time, and when we paid our bill, the waitress gave us this red Christmassy-looking sealed envelope. She said they were giving them to their good customers. And inside was a free gift, like free breadsticks or free salad bar or even a free pizza. So I put it in the glove box of the car and we left. A number of times when we weren't there, I would think about it or see it in the glove box. But the week before we left on vacation, on Thursday night, we went down and we had pizza. We got inside and then I remembered, I thought, that red envelope is out in the glove box. So I ran back out on the street to where we'd parked the car. I got it and I brought it in. We opened it up in front of the waitress. We had a free large pizza, which is what we always order because we love to take the leftovers home with us. And when I presented the gift card to our waitress, she pointed to the fine print at the bottom that said, offer expires May 31st. And this was the second week in June. The more time you think you have, the greater your tendency is to be late. And a lot of people are dealing with Jesus Christ and their salvation in exactly the same way. They think they have a lot of time to make a decision, but greater becomes their tendency to be late. Let me tell you something that's horribly true. Don't dilly-dally with God. You don't have a lot of time. Your willful unbelief, according to John 12 and Isaiah 53, will lead to a time when you can't believe. I didn't say it. God said it. The singer will have left the stage and it would be too late So when he calls you, come to him quickly. Joe Namath promised that the Jets would beat the Colts in Super Bowl III, and nobody believed him. The score? 16-7 Jets. Secondly, I want you to see that unbelief is often the result of fear. Verse 42, many people did believe in him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders, but they wouldn't admit it for fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue. You see what's going on here? John says many people, even the leaders of the Jews, the Pharisees, believed in Jesus, but they were afraid to confess their belief because it would cost them too much. They were afraid to confess their belief because it would cost them too much. There are people all over the world like that today. John says they were afraid they would be kicked out of the synagogue, and that was a big deal. That means they would be excommunicated from the Jewish way of life. The synagogue was the center of Jewish living. Your social life revolved around the synagogue. The synagogue is where you went to church. The synagogue school is where your children were educated. The synagogue is where you got your kosher food to eat that had been blessed by a rabbi. If you were excommunicated from Judaism and kicked out of the synagogue, it would cost you a lot. But if you said no to Jesus, it would cost you your soul. You see, there are two Greek words used in the Gospel of John for unbelief. One is used for authentic unbelief, which meant that they really didn't believe Jesus was who he said he was. And the other is used for a coward's belief. In other words, you believe Jesus is who he says he is, but you're not willing to pay the price for what it would cost to follow him. You would rather be in good standing with men than to stand with God. And things haven't changed in the past 2,000 years. There are people all over this world who believe that Jesus is who he says he is, the Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, but they're afraid to give up what it would cost them to follow him, a coward's belief. And remember, the decision is not conditional. It's all or nothing. There's no neutral gear with God. You're either for him or against him. You either accept him or reject him. I imagine even the disciples counted the cost of following Jesus, but in the end they followed. I mean, after all, they had to be practical about their decision. They had a nice fishing business to consider. They had a reputation in the community, families to feed. And after all, fishing for men may sound good, but how much can you get per pound when you're fishing for men? In Matthew 8, a teacher of the law comes to Jesus and he says, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus says, "Foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." Did you know that in the entirety of the New Testament, not one time is there mentioned a possession of Jesus? Not one time. Not one time did it say that Jesus had a home that they stayed in. He was always staying in somebody else's home. Not one time did it talk about Jesus having a camel. He was always walking every place that he went. Not one time did it talk about Jesus getting a new pair of sandals or getting a new tunic. Not one time does it talk about possessions of Jesus at all. That ought to tell us something. In 1800, they put an ad in a French magazine for a priest to come to the United States as a missionary. And this is what it said. "We offer no salary, no recompense, no holidays, no pension, but much hard work, a poor dwelling, many disappointments, frequent sickness, a violent and lonely death, and an unknown grave." And yet we 21st century Christians gripe and complain when the sanctuary is too hot or too cold. Following Christ is unconditional. It's either all or nothing. You don't go to Jesus and say, "Jesus, I'll follow you if you'll bless my business and make me rich. Jesus, I'll follow you if I can keep my lust and my adultery." You don't go to Jesus and say, "Hey, Jesus, I'll follow you if I'll always be happy and never have to face tragedy." It doesn't work that way. It's either all or nothing. You don't negotiate your salvation. You know what the number one rule of wing walking is? Never let go of what you've got until you've got a hold of something better. Never let go of what you've got until you've got a hold of something better. But you see, all that rule falls apart when you start talking about following Jesus. Because he demands that you let go of everything else but him. It's all or nothing. And some people simply are not willing to make that decision. Thirdly, I want you to see that unbelief is often the result of an improper need. Verse 43, for they loved human praise more than the praise of God. Now, this is along the same line as what we just discussed in the last point, but it goes further. At this point, they refused to believe because of other people. And the Bible makes it clear that when you do things for the praise of men, you've received your reward in full. I care less about what people think of me than most people. Part of it, I think, is a personality thing. Love, on the other hand, seeks approval. She likes to be liked and accepted. But I really don't get my feelings hurt if somebody doesn't like me. Now, let me admit that it hasn't always been that way. Let me tell you where the hard shell has come from. It comes from living in a fishbowl as a pastor for 30 years and being criticized and attacked and gossiped about and lied about and falsely accused. And after 30 years of that, I really don't care what people think. I can't. And here's why. At the end of the day, I have only one person in the universe to please. And I desperately want to please him because he was executed in my place on a cross. And if I lay down my head on the pillow at night and go to sleep knowing that I pleased him, then it doesn't matter to me what anybody else thinks, because I'm a lot more scared of him than I am of anybody else. Be careful seeking the praise of men. I remember when we went into the ministry 30 years ago, we left Chicago on a Saturday. We'd loaded up the moving van and they took off for East Tennessee, and we had the car. Love had the boys in there within him. It was completely loaded. I had the pickup truck. It was completely loaded. And we left and we spent Saturday night with Mom and Dad down in Brownstown. Gary Morning knew that we were coming through. He was a preacher at Brownstown Christian Church. And he said, Bill, now that you're ordained, you're going into the ministry, why don't you preach that Sunday morning as you're coming down and spend the night with your parents? And so I said, okay. The first time I'd ever preached other than in that little church up in Chicago. I remember being scared to death, and I went down to Brownstown Christian where I'd grown up and walked in for first service, and I looked out and the place was full. And it was people that had watched me grow up in that town. They knew the Bill BC before Christ, and they wanted to see if there really was a Bill Lockman after Christ. I could have gotten up in the pulpit and not said a word and preached a sermon that morning. They were mostly curiosity seekers. I preached second service. It was full too, and afterwards, I was so blessed and encouraged going into my first week in a ministry in a new church in the mountains of Tennessee, because all those people who had watched me grow up, they hugged me and told me that I did great, told me they'd be praying for me, that they loved me, they were proud of me, except for one guy. He came up to me in the hallway after second service. He shook my hand and he said, Bill, I've heard a lot of preachers say that they were sinners, but you're the first one I've ever really believed. Be careful seeking the praise of men. You've received your reward in full. Some people never declare their belief in Jesus and accept him because they are afraid of what people would say. They're afraid of giving up their reputation. How foolish. How tragic. To seek the approval of man for a moment and lose the company of God for eternity. And then fourthly, I want you to see that unbelief is often the result of secrecy. Verse 42, many people did not believe in him, or did believe in him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders, but they wouldn't admit it for fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue. Let me give you a principle that I think is true. Belief will destroy secrecy, or secrecy will destroy belief. Let me say it again. Belief will destroy secrecy, or secrecy will destroy belief. A number of years ago down in Florida, I had a couple come to me who wanted to get married. I agreed to do their wedding. We set the date, and before the date arrived, I took care of their premarital counseling in my office. The night of the rehearsal, both families showed up. It was a good rehearsal. And after the rehearsal, I cornered the groom and I said, listen, I need your license, your paperwork, so I can get everything filled out and ready to sign before tomorrow. Who has that? You or the bride? And the groom pulled me way off in a corner, away from everybody else, and he hem-hawed around. And eventually, he looked me in the eye and he said, we don't have any paperwork. I said, you what? If you haven't pulled your license and you don't have the legal paperwork, then I can't marry you tomorrow. It would be illegal for me to do so. And then he said, Pastor, let me explain to you. He said, we've been legally married with all the paperwork for 2 years. We were married secretly before, and nobody knows except the two of us and the man who married us, and now you. He said, we'd like to keep it that way. He said, what we're doing is we're reconfirming publicly what we did in secret 2 years ago. I said, you haven't been married for 2 years. You've simply had a piece of paper in the drawer. Because you see, the very nature of marriage is that it's public. That's why you invite family and friends. That's why they put it in the paper for the public to read about it. It's a public coming together to make public declarations and promises of your love to one another as you enter into a marriage covenant with God, as He joins you publicly together as one flesh. You haven't been married. The very nature of the Christian faith is like that too. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, you don't join a secret society. When you become a Christian, you didn't become a member of God's secret service. You joined a movement that has publicly swept the entire world for the past 2,000 years. Martyrs have died and given their lives for the cause of Christianity. Wars have been fought between nations over the kingdom of God. It's to be public. We're to shout it from the rooftops. We're to confess it before men wherever we go. How do I know? Because it says so in the Bible. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says this, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it's with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Matthew 10, 32 and 33, he who confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father in heaven. You see, belief will destroy secrecy, or secrecy will destroy belief. If you say you believe in Jesus and that you never confess him or mention his name in your daily conversation, you need to check the validity of what you believe. And then fifthly and finally and very quickly, unbelief is often the result of the refusal to recognize authority. Verses 40 and 45, Jesus shouted to the crowds, if you trust me, you are trusting not only me, but also God who sent me. For when you see me, you are seeing the one who sent me. 49 and 50. I don't speak on my own authority. The Father who sent me has commanded me what to say and how to say it. And I know his commands lead to eternal life. So I say whatever the Father tells me to say. Let me tell you something. The most important decision you will ever make is about the nature of Jesus of Nazareth. I mean, if Jesus is just gentle Jesus, meek and mild, sweet and bland and boring, you can ignore him. If Jesus was just a good man doing good things, taught well, had some nice things to say about God, then you don't have to obey him. But let me tell you something. If he is the Messiah, the all-powerful Son of God, the Savior of the world, then you cannot ignore him. And you have to make a decision about him and his authority. Because one day you will bow your knees before that authority. And you will hear these words coming out of your mouth, Jesus, you are Lord. I guarantee it's going to happen. Back when I was a police officer, I had a pursuit case that went to court and almost got thrown out. I was working in plain clothes without a uniform on. I was in an unmarked car that didn't even have red or blue lights in the grill or in the back window. It only had a spotlight on the driver's side. It was a detective's car. The nature of what I was doing was more of a stakeout and gathering information. But before the night was over, a crime took place in my presence, and I had to make an arrest. I ran over to where the crime was taking place. I identified myself as a police officer, and I showed my badge. And from that moment on, the pursuit was on. The criminal that I was chasing ran into a house and out the back door and over a fence. He circled back around to the front of the house, got into a car parked there, and drove away. I was right on his heels when he locked the door of the car and squealed out of the driveway. So I went down the block. I got into my unmarked car, and I gave chase. I caught up with him and was running right beside him, shining a spotlight in his eyes, flashing my badge at him, trying to get him to pull over and to stop. After about a five-mile chase, this guy crashes down a ravine. He flees on foot, gets away, but is caught about 2 hours later. The case went to court, and the defense attorney was trying to get the whole thing thrown out because he said, I didn't identify myself as a police officer. He said, did you have a marked car identified by your department insignia and emergency lighting? And I said, no. He said, were you wearing a uniform that identified you as a police officer? And I said, no. He said, then why should my client have thought you were a police officer and stopped for your arrest? I said, because I verbally identified myself as a police officer and I showed him my badge. The defense attorney said, anybody can say they're a police officer. You didn't expect him to stop for that, did you? I said, I expected him to stop for the authority of the badge. Things weren't going my way at all. And all of a sudden, the judge leaned over to the defendant and he said, did you see his badge? And this poor guy, everything going for him, he makes the mistake of saying, yes, I saw the badge. And the judge said, guilty of felony fleeing. You should have submitted to the authority of the badge. You should have submitted to the authority of the badge. Jesus has a badge too. It's hanging up there above my head. The cross is his badge. The empty tomb is his badge. And they give him all the authority in the universe. When you're going to submit to that authority? I'm his badge, a life that's been changed. You're his badge, a life that's been changed. Broken hearts that have been healed, tears that have been dried, those are badges, those are signs of his authority. But a lot of people still don't believe, and they still haven't submitted to his authority, authority that became his on a cross. Somebody tells a story about a ship that was sailing through the dark black water on a dark black night. And the seaman who was out on the deck and on watch that night looked up and he saw a light in the distance. And the seaman relayed the message to the captain, and the captain ordered the following message to be sent: request that you alter your course 10 degrees to the south. And a reply came back to that message that said, request that you alter your course 10 degrees to the north. The captain, being a little bit ticked at the reply, sent another message: I request that you change your course 10 degrees to the south. I am the captain. And the reply came back: request you change your course 10 degrees to the north. I'm a third-class seaman. And this time, the captain really was ticked. He was going to let the person know. And so he sent this message: request that you alter your course 10 degrees to the south. I am a battleship. And the reply came back: request you change your course 10 degrees to the north. I am a lighthouse. Jesus is a lighthouse too. He's unmovable. He never changes. He makes you an offer. He died on a cross in your place, and he wants your life to be different and to have meaning. He wants you to be free and be forgiven. And his offer hangs there on that cross. He's not going to change it. He won't make deals. He won't beg you. Just go to him and ask. Because the alternatives are too horrible to mention. I started out this morning saying that there are two kinds of people in the world: believers in Jesus Christ and unbelievers. And the truth is that our job as believers is them, the unbelievers. We're here for them. We're beggars who have found bread, and our job is to tell other beggars where they can find it too. Believers, unbelievers. I think I'll let Mark Lowry kind of sum up what I've been saying this morning. Let me finish with this.
You know, because, you know, you get a back porch like I've got now. I got me a gas grill. Got the biggest sugar maple tree in Nashville hanging over my porch. At least that's what the former owners told me. when they were trying to sell the dump. And I got me a gas grill and I got it all set up and I invited some friends over and I was all excited and have them in my new house and invited Norman and Brenda, who's here tonight, and then they invited some friends of theirs and that I had not met until this moment in time. And we had the steaks, you know, I grilled the steaks myself. And I found out if you get a cheap piece of meat and put enough garlic on it, it'll taste like a filet mignon. So I grilled the steaks, and Norman brought the baked beans, and Brenda brought some potato salad, and somebody else brought tea, and we were just having a good time. And afterwards, we were having coffee, you know, like adults do, and we were talking about politics, which I know nothing about, but it's never stopped me from having an opinion. And we were saying this, and I said, you know, I vote this way because I'm a Christian and I believe certain things and that I want to, you know, see happen or whatever. And Nancy, who was a friend of Brenda's, spoke up and said, well, I don't believe in God. And I vote the opposite of you. I didn't care how she voted. All I heard was, I don't believe in God. I got so excited. I'd never had one in my home before. I went around and locked all the doors. I said, you're going to be here a while. Oh, we had a wonderful time. I started explaining. I said, you know what? I would be an atheist too if I had that much faith. It takes a lot of faith to believe all the order around us evolved from some gaseous belch in the universe 6 billion years ago. You know, order never comes from chaos unless somebody puts it together. All the order in the universe. You know, if I took my watch apart, my Timex Indiglo, I love my watch. I was up all night looking at that watch. But every 15 minutes, I was checking it last night. But what if I took it off my arm and took it totally apart and stuck the pieces in the sack and then I shook the sack for 6 billion years? What if after 6 billion years, what would be the chances of me pulling out a watch that's ticking and on time? I don't even have enough faith for that. I certainly don't have enough faith to think that this complicated universe around us, and even in our bodies, DNA, they've just in the last few years discovered DNA. I've had it all along. And look at your thumbprint. Everybody look at your thumbprint right now. Did you know that's an original? You are thumb body. There ain't another one like you in the world. I don't have enough faith to believe all the order around us came from chaos. And once you realize you don't have enough faith to believe that there isn't a God, you need to go on the hunt to find out who this God is. And you know what? For us to know God, he'd have had to find us in this great big universe. How are we going to find God? The best we can do is send a Tonka truck to Mars. And it hit our going to find God. He found us. But you know what?
Let God find you if you don't belong to him, because he's looking. And he wants you to say yes to him. If you're an unbeliever, we want to give you the chance to cross that line to belief this morning. And we do that by just saying a simple prayer. So if you close your eyes and bow your heads, and if you don't belong to him, and the Spirit has moved you from unbelief to curious, we hope you'll pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, I know that I'm not a good person. In fact, I would consider myself a bad person. And I know that the sin that's a part of my life separates me from you forever. However, I know that you loved me so much that you sent your only son to die in my place. And while I don't understand all that, I'm to the point in my life where I want to accept it. I want to cross over from unbelief to belief, and I believe that Jesus died on a cross in my place. I believe that they placed him in a tomb, and I believe that on Sunday morning he walked out of that tomb. And as I said before, I'm not good, but I want to belong to you. So I surrender my life at the foot of the cross to you. And I want Jesus to rule my life and be my Savior. And that's my prayer this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, we want to know before you leave. We won't do it where it embarrasses you publicly, but if you would come to one of us at the back door and let us know that you accepted Christ through that prayer. We want to talk to you about some things that are yours now. We want to talk to you about the ordination and inauguration of your relationship with Jesus, which is to go into the waters of baptism and be obedient as Christ was obedient and set the example for us. Do that before you leave if you said that prayer. Stand with me now. We're going to offer an invitation.